Welcome to Section 5, Minimal IMAP. In the previous section, we saw that if you have a number of conditional independences included in a distribution, and you're asked whether that distribution satisfies a particular factorization, then you can simply check whether the local conditional independences in this graph are included in IP or not. And then for this close to real world problem, we saw that the answer was yes. So this graph was an IMAP for P. And we saw that it's not the only IMAP, okay? Now, the question is like, can we somehow, so there can be several IMAPs, of course, can we somehow define a minimal IMAP? And what do I mean by that? So let's see an example. Given a conditional independence, the distribution P does not factorize uniquely, okay? We already know that. Consider this distribution P that that satisfies this conditional independence. We already have seen that in the previous slides. X4 is independent of X3, of X1 and X2, condition on X3, and we also include its derivations. Like, for example, X4 is independent of X1, condition on X3, and so on. Anything that can be concluded from this. Okay, so the following graph is an IMAP. Why? Because if I write down the local independencies, I will see that it will be equal to this term here, which matches exactly the one here. It is included, therefore it is an IMAP for P. But also G2 here, another graph, this is a completely connected graph, a fully connected graph, acyclic, and you can check that this does not impose any conditional independence. So for each node, every other node will be either its parent or its descendant. So it doesn't impose anything. It will be empty, and of course, empty is a subset of any set, including the set here, so it is an IMAP. Okay, it's basically the chain rule, nothing surprising here. So both of them are an IMAP, so it's not unique. IMAP is not, does not provide a unique factorization. Now, there is, however, something specific about the second graph. You see it's more crowded. In particular, you see that if I delete this edge and this this link and the above link here, I will get exactly G1, okay? So these two edges, if they are deleted, then I will end up at G1, which is still an IMAP for P. So there is some redundancy in that graph. But what about G1, for example? Can we take out an edge and preserve the IMAP? So for example, I had G1 here, if you recall. Now, if I take out a link, like the one between X2 and X3, I will end up in this G prime 1. And what are the local independences here? Well, I can say at least one of them is this one. X3 being conditioned on its parent, X1, then it will become independent of its non-descendants, which is X2. Okay, so this is now included. And we already saw, I guess in the previous slides, that this is not included here, because it is now conditioned only on X1 and none of the derivations of this term will result in that. So this is imposing a conditional independence that is not included in P, and therefore it is not an IMAP for P. So what happened? I took G1, I took out an edge, and I saw that it does not become an IMAP anymore for P. As an exercise, you can check that if you actually delete any of the links of G1, it will not be an IMAP anymore. We call this graph a minimal IMAP for P. So formally, a graph G is a minimal IMAP for P, not just IMAP, but a minimal one, if, of course, it is an IMAP, and additionally, if the removal of any edge from that graph makes it not an IMAP. So every link counts, okay? Now, are we done? Are minimal IMAPs unique? So I no longer need to check between several minimal IMAPs. Let's get back to our example with the mentioned conditional independence. We already saw that G1 was a minimal IMAP for this distribution P. Now, if I simply reverse the direction of x1 to x2, like this, we can see that still it is an IMAP for P. Why? Well, for x4, I can easily check that the local independence that it imposes is x4 condition on its parent x3 will be independent of its non-descendants x1 and x2. Okay, what about x3? Well, x3 has the parents x1 and x2, and from here, and the other left node is x4, which is its descendant, so it doesn't give me anything. What about x2? X2 doesn't have a parent, but all the other nodes are its descendants. So this one will not give me anything either. What about x1? x1, well, okay, x2 is its parent, and then the remaining ones are its descendants. So this one will not give me anything either, okay? So I will end up exactly the same condition as before. And indeed, we will later see that by reversing this link here, we didn't need to do any of this checking. We could immediately say that this does not affect any of the conditional independences imposed by this graph. Okay, so, and from there, you can verify it yourself. We can say that this is also a minimal IMAP. You can check by deleting any of these edges, it will no longer be an IMAP. Okay, so both of them are minimal IMAP. So what happened? Even minimal IMAPs are not unique. Okay, and now you may say that, okay, is it only because of the reversing of the direction of the links? Well, not always. So here's another example. It is not just about reversing the directions. So even they can have different structures. So consider this other distribution here, x independent of y, x independent of z, and y independent of z. And you can show that there won't be any other non-trivial derivation here. So I'm just considering these three. This is known as the actual XOR example that we will later get back to it. So only these three. Note that this does not imply that, for example, x and y is independent of y and z together, okay, or any other independence. Now, look, interestingly, each of these three are an IMAP for P. So for example, this one. What are the local independences here? For x, I have condition on nothing. It is independent of its non-descendant, which is y, which is this one here. And the same for y, because it's symmetric. What about z? Well, z, the remaining nodes are its parents, so it won't give me anything. So the only conditional, local conditional independence is this one. Okay? Similarly, for this, I can show that x and z are independent. By the way, it's quite interesting. So x and z are independent even though they are both pointing to another node. Okay? And if I know the value of y, though, that would be something different. It's like two people, I don't know anything if they're sharing something or not, but then the moment I know that they have a common child, then I know that they will be linked to each other. We'll get back to that later also. And similarly here. So I have three different structures. All of them are an IMAP for P. Now, here's the more interesting part. All of them are also minimal IMAPs, okay? Because if I remove any of the links, say here, if I remove x to z, what will happen? Well, then x, I know that x will be independent of z and y, which is together, that's already something new. But also, for example, what happened is that z will condition on y, it will be independent of x. So this conditional independence is not included here. Okay? And therefore, it's no longer an IMAP. So it is minimal. All three are minimal. They have the same number of edges. And it's not that we reversed anything. It's just that the structures are completely different. Okay? So that's the story with IMAP. Minimal IMAPs can have them. There's several possibilities for a structure to be minimal IMAP. Back to our example sheet in practice. We were given this graph. We asked whether the graph is an IMAP for P. Yes. Is it the only IMAP for P? No. What about the minimal IMAP? Is it a minimal IMAP? You can check that the answer is yes. Is it the only minimal IMAP? How to answer that? Okay, we just saw that yes, we can have several minimal IMAPs, but what about the given case, like this one? Can we immediately say that no, there isn't, or yes, there is? And we'll get back to, we will answer this in the next video. Just to summarize, we ended up last time here, we had the data set, we had its conditional independences, and then we had several possibilities for factorization. We said in order to find out which one is a good fit, we need to write down the local independences that each of these Bayesian nets or factorizations are imposing. And then we saw that the first three are satisfying this. And then out of these three, only the first two are a minimal IMAP. Okay? Because this one, for example, here, if I just delete the link from D to M, it will become exactly as this one. And I already know that this is an IMAP. So this is not a minimal IMAP. Okay, I'm deleting an edge and it will still be an IMAP. So there is some redundancy here. These two are minimal IMAPs. You can check that if I delete this, for example, I will end up with the new conditional independence that C will become independent of both M and D. Okay, and that is not included here. It's together, both of them. So they are, I end up with two minimal IMAPs. I can still ask which one, but let's just hold it here. Thanks for your attention.